I'll briefly introduce the study, which basically is, like, I would say, the basis or the reason why we're meeting here today. Essentially, like Simon and Hans were already saying, this was a study that CEP did, commissioned by the German Foreign Office, where we looked at a string of countries and the situation in those countries vis-a-vis basically what Jakub is going to be calling right-wing terrorism. We were looking more into the direction of what we call the violent extreme right wing, but essentially when you hear these two terms, we mean the same thing, and they're close enough, I hope, for you to recognize that. Essentially, I will explain why we touched upon those six countries as I go throughout the presentation, because there is a point there in the presentation where it is neatly, let's say, explained. So I will not start at the beginning, but here you have the main points that we covered in the report. As Hans said, we have, of course, encourage you and urge you to have a look at this work. It's not only a report of circa 50 pages, which is a kind of like a thematic analysis, but it very much explains of what we wanted to do. We sought the best experts we could find on the extreme right-wing violence in those six countries that I will tell you about more in a second. These individuals wrote chapters of parts of this very report, which form the basis of the then subsequent thematic analysis, which is the end product is the document of 50 pages, the kind of first part of the major study, which is followed by those national chapters submitted by those renowned international experts. So again, please do have a look. I will briefly touch upon the main issues, especially from the first part, from the first document, the thematic analysis, if I could put it this way, to use an academic term. But then obviously there is way, way more. It all runs more to 150 pages plus. It's extremely well sourced and documented. And I and Hans and Alexander Ritzman were delighted to actually be the editors of this very process. But without further ado, let's look at the things that emerged in our report. So essentially, we are looking at a movement which is transnational, which is no longer nationalists versus nationalists. It's a kind of like a post-nationalist movement, if we could put it this way, which is united by a couple of things. Hans already alluded to that. It's a movement that is united by narratives. So essentially, it's no longer French versus German, British versus German, Dutch versus German, or I don't know, French versus Spanish. It's essentially a movement that is animated by similar things, which are recognized across the board, across different organizations, grouplets, and networks that actually form the bedrock of this very movement. And Hans alluded to some of them, narratives like white genocide, great replacement, new world order, if you like, a new set of challenges, a new set of enemies, a new set of issues for such a transnational nationalist movement, because they still call themselves nationalists. They don't like, obviously, the phrase far right, extreme right. They want to be seen as nationalists or patriots. These are the kind of overarching themes that emerged in our research. That it's a movement, and that might be a bit of a surprise, that's united by variety. So it's a movement which no longer is uber hierarchical, that wants to model itself on just like a one set of guiding principles in terms of organization and structure. They love different forms of organization. They accept that. They are all for this approach. They want to be, varied, if I could put it this way. And they don't mind if there is a party leading a certain sector of the violent extreme right wing in a given country. And in another country, it's a set of individuals. In another country, it's essentially, well, a gang. In another country, it could be a network. All is fine, as long as you subscribe to the main message, which I just touched upon in point A. This movement, and again, Hans alluded to that in the opening words, it's a movement that is united by travel. So they do travel to similar places where they meet, where they want to, so to speak, propagate their message, where they want to recruit new members, where they want to fundraise, and where they want to network, essentially. So this is, you will find them in certain places, not all of them and not always. And of course, past COVID, because we were writing that also from a pre-COVID perspective, in which that these groups would convey in certain places. I'll be talking about these places in a second. So please bear with me for a moment. So the travel patterns of these individuals are very similar, not only the places that they go to, but also the countries. And I'll be speaking to that exactly right now. So This is a movement that is united by a set of inspirations. And that's, we get to the key point, why we looked at a certain number of countries. So we looked at six, because we do think that this is a movement which is basically, or has always been, looking up to the Anglo-Saxons. The Anglo-Saxons speak the language which they should all somehow know, not always do, which, you know, which is a source of, you know, funny situations amongst them, because that obviously prevents some of the communication. But essentially, this is the language that binds them in a way, but also the culture that binds them. You look up to the Americans and to the Brits, you look up to the Hollywood imagery, and it works also in this milieu. It's not only in pop culture, it also works for the extreme right. You would be checking out what the Americans are doing. And of course, this has shifted in the last years, and I'll be talking about that later on. But to a large extent, it holds. There is also some literature coming out of the US, which is influential. There are some influential, basically, ideologues, if I could put it this way, that animate the scene, Anglo-Saxon. Then, obviously, this is a movement which is looking up to Germany. You know, for better or worse, again, they look up to the Germans as the originators of this whole thing. And being friendly with Germans, having contacts there, traveling there, having the connections, is seen essentially, and I apologize, my language is seen as cool. And that's why you would see all these groups, almost all of them, pilgrimaging to Germany to meet up with their counterparts. That does not mean that those German groups are like superbly, superbly strong, or that they actually run this whole endeavor. That's not the case. Quite often they are, you know, they're a bit like an anti-climax, but in essentially, it's like a box to be ticked off. So the German influence. Then you have the Scandinavian influence. The Scandinavian influence, on one hand, the imagery, the sagas, the Vikings, the pure people of the North, blonde, blue-eyed, etc., etc., etc. That still plays a role. And of course, the big scenes, the big skinhead scenes, violent scenes of the 1980s and the 1990s in places like Sweden and Finland still animate this thing. Plus, Scandinavia recently has a transnational violent, well, essentially a terrorist organization, the Nordic Resistance Movement, which is an example of a functioning transnational body like that. So people also look up to it, and they look up to Scandinavia in this sense. That's why we tackled Sweden and Finland in this research of ours. And lastly, we also looked at France, which has a vibrant, fragmented, divided, not huge, but, you know, vibrant in the sense that attached to a bigger political project, far-right scene. France, that is the basically probably the last place in Europe where the far-right made a stand actually attempting to do a coup. Well, that's been quite a few years ago, but still, you know, you have to, inverted commas, appreciate that. And France as a source of some of the ideologies, you know, the greater price replacement, you know, it's coming from France. That is also basically a vibrant intellectual place for the far right and the extreme right. And that's why, one of the reasons why we decided to look at it. Nextly, this is a movement that's united by a couple of things, not just by those travels, national influences, and variety and things like that, and narratives. It's influenced, as Hans alluded to, by music, sports, money, and violence. So I'll tackle this quickly. So basically, when we say music, that means that these individuals go to music festivals, they consume music, they would love to, especially post-COVID, consume music together. And music could be a source of funds and recruitment. I've heard on many occasions while actually doing my research that, you know, I'm not a Nazi, I just like the same music that they do. You know, I go to the same places, go to the same festivals, it doesn't make me a Nazi. Well, in certain cases, it actually did end up, you know, the way that the given individuals started consuming more propaganda, started being friendly with the so-called Nazis in this case. So think of festivals, then think of sport. We mostly looked at the violent sport. You know, we don't yet consider football a violent sport, but there's actually quite a lot of it going around in football. I'm sorry, I had to say this, you know, I'm Polish and the Polish league is very brutal in terms of, like, you know, people kicking one another on the pitch. But we mostly focused on the MMA. So the mixed martial arts, this as a driver, this as an engine for the very movement. That's not to say that all MMA is neo-Nazi or extreme right or far right. No, far from it. But there are segments and elements of that. And obviously you would have huge fights, huge tournaments being organized in different places. You would have like permanent clubs where such individuals would flock. And again, on top of that, you would have the propaganda. On top of that, you would have the merchandise. You would have the fundraising. You would have the networking. You would have the planning. So that was like a safe space. These two sometimes would be actually music and sports consumed together. Thirdly, and you know, the cap above this, it's the money. So music and sports is not just going there, it's actually spending the money on the ticket, spending the money on the CD, spending the money on the t-shirt, spending the money on beer, etc., 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 etc. This as a driver, and we do write about that in the report, saying, hey, that actually can be, not always is, but it can be a source of funds for these individuals. And at the end of the day, when you have the recruits and when you have the money, supposedly this very milieu, this very scene would have to go for violence. Now, we will be talking more about the violence later on, also in the Q&A, but supposedly this should be the injection. It's not always successful, but it's not that the movement is not trying. We've identified in the report quite a few organizations that actually did try to stage pretty spectacular terrorist attacks. They did not come into fruition, mostly because they were intercepted by the security services, and they were intercepted because they were staged by organizations. And you know, the best conspiracies, as probably it's not a novelty to say this, especially in a webinar on the extreme right, are the conspiracies of one. So that's why there is this kind of thinking that the extreme right, it's about, you know, the violence coming from them, it's about the plots by the individuals who go out and shoot up, I don't know, a synagogue, a mosque, places like that. And they are individuals, they are the so-called lone wolves. They're usually pretty well connected in the milieu, usually online. They might be loners socially, but they're not really lone wolves. And it's not that the bigger organizations are not trying. Happily take the, you know, follow up on that in the Q&A session, and there's lots of it in the report. I'll just mention one. Probably not many people heard about the fact that there were actually extreme right or far right organizations in France that were actually trying to kill President Macron, French Minister of Interior. These plots did not succeed, but they were advanced, and we would have to remember about them when actually discussing this very milieu. The next issue is that we wanted to tackle and we wanted to look at, and everyone's been talking about this, and also after January the 6th and the events in the US, is the online element. Quite on many occasions, we hear that the online is the reason why they're strong, the online is the element why that's such a big threat, and we wanted to look at it critically. In our view, yes, there is there is offline online symbiosis. That's not, you know, that wouldn't be a surprise. But in certain cases, the offline was actually born online, and that speaks volumes about the symbiosis. And I'll give you some examples of that. So essentially, you have a situation in which certain groups, grouplets, networks actually came together online first, and then went into the offline world. That's especially true in the US, where certain organizations came together on some extreme right forums for us and then migrated into the real life. But the big question is, and that's point E actually on this very slide, is that, is it operational? Is the online operational, or is it just inspirational? We've seen a lot of such stuff going on with the jihadi milieu, which was basically perfectly joining the online with the offline. You would have commands being given online, you would have the propaganda online, you would have the wings giving online, and then actually acted upon in real life. To a lesser extent, we have seen that in real life vis-a-vis the terrorist plots of the extreme right. Of course, we can debate the 6th of January, and I'll gladly do that. And I am happy that Hans alluded to the fact that there will be a US event focused on that, because obviously that's maybe not a new dimension, but it's a dimension of a mass event. That's not a terrorist event, you know, grouping 5, 10, 15, 20 people. That's a mass event that was advertised online and actually ended up in such a way. And that's why we're saying that in many cases with the right-wing terrorism and the right-wing violence, the offline is actually lagging behind online. You know, the amount of memes, the amount of posts, the amount of Telegram channels now does not actually automatically translate into the number of terroristic plots which are out there in real life. You know, they don't need that, but that's for the Q&A session. The fourth point that we tackled in our report was basically the response. So we looked at those six countries, and the first thing that we stumbled upon was the fact that, you know, there is a struggle vis-a-vis the definition. Terrorism is defined in the legal orders, but not always, you know, hello, United States, of the six countries. But then there's the problem with extremism. You know, quite often the definition just hangs on the level of the administrative definition, There is no legal definition. There is a lot, there are competing definitions, which makes certain things more difficult from the point of view of people wanting to actually tackle it from a policy or counter counter-extremism or counter-terrorism in this sense perspective. And we looked at different models, how different countries amongst those six actually tried to tackle this very threat. We basically were able to isolate three, if I could put it this way. I'll start the Scandinavian, which is more prevention-oriented. And this is, you basically see a linear progression from Denmark, Sweden picking up the Danish experiences from countering jihadists, and then also implementing them. You have elements of that in Finland. You have a multifaceted model, which is certainly the UK model, where there's a bit of prevention and a bit of, you know, harder counter-terrorism, the counter-terrorism tools, which are not always used to counter this threat. Because it's seen as extremism, you do not deploy counter-terrorism tools to actually combat extremism in certain countries. Well, UK does that. Germany is slightly moving in that direction, or maybe actually looking in those both directions of the softer approach, the preventative approach, and also the harder, the counter-terrorism approach, or the policing approach, if I could put it this way. So we also put it in that group. And the last group is the counter-internet, the counter-crime approaches. And, you know, no surprise there, France is leading the way, where very little prevention is being done and quite a lot, you know, of reliance on actually how do we tackle this. Well, we utilize the same security architecture that we developed for tackling other conspiracies and other ideological types of terrorism, which had also been successfully utilized back in the day in the 1960s when the Organization of the Secret Army tried to actually overthrow the legal government of France. So it's a kind of like a pendulum that is swinging. US would also be in that group, and again, no surprise there, but we indicated that there are elements of the preventive approach that US is putting in place, and we might be thinking, and we would, you know, it would be an expectation, obviously, that under the new administration, these might be even reinforced more to actually tackle the wider group, maybe not the terrorists as such, but, you know, the causes that lead people into radicalization, into the ranks of terrorist organizations, or basically domestic terrorist organizations, as the US would actually call it. So we split it into these three categories. And essentially, I'll stop here. As I said, it is a massive report, very well sourced. It's been a pleasure working on it. And again, hat off to Simon and his team at the ministry, and then again to Hans. Look forward to your questions, and I look forward to Jakob's presentation on I wouldn't call it absolutely a rival, but I would say the masterclass in how you should actually work on right-wing terrorism in the European, or basically global, or transnational setting. Thank you again, and look forward to your questions.